of Luke chapter 18. I want to look in the book of Luke chapter 18. If you can stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God. Let's look at Luke chapter 18 and verse 9 and verse 14. I know your passage of scripture. Luke chapter 18, verse 9 through 14. And he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other was a publican. Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I'm not like other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican standing afar off would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful unto me, a sinner. Tell you that this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbled himself shall be exalted. I want to ask you a question this morning. Are you overdressed? Amen. Are you overdressed? Think about that. Are you overdressed? I thought about this when I was getting dressed this morning myself, which I think I look really nice. And y'all look nice too. Let me take a seat. Thinking about this morning. Now, so many times we put so much emphasis on our external appearances. And the more we put emphasis we put on appearances, the more we have to keep up appearances.
That's right.
Have you ever noticed that the more makeup you put on, the more you have to keep on putting layer after layer, the more mascara. You know, I pick up my wife because I say, how long do your lashes have to be? The latest, greatest mascara they come out with, I gotta have it. But it's funny that the more that we accent ourselves, the more that we feel like we have to put on clothing-wise, just on the external, the more it feels like this is never enough. We go farther and farther and farther and farther and not understanding that sometimes less is more. Sometimes it's good to be simplistic in our approach to how we appear to men, in our approach to how God sees us. And I think one of the most beautiful, or the most beautiful thing about the way God deals with his people is the principle of grace. And grace is simply God saying that you don't have what it takes. You will never have enough. You will never be able to pay me back for what I've done for you. All the righteous works in the world, you can't cook enough chicken dinners. You can't go visit enough people in the hospital. You can't come to church if you just camped out and slept in the church. If you prayed 24 hours a day, if you speak in tongues, if you work 9, 10, 12, 14 gifts of the Spirit, if you heal the sick and raise the dead, you will never measure up to the amount of grace that I placed upon your life. It's an amazing thing how much grace God has favored upon, because when we look at one another, amen, we're surprised that God could do so much with so little. But then interestingly, when we look at ourselves, we're surprised that God could do so much with even less. If you're honest with yourself, you'll wonder how in the world did God allow little old me to be where I am right now. Because I should have been gone. We should have been dead. We should have had and sometimes we can think about the times in our life that where we had near-death experiences. An accident that we were in, or almost were in, but it seems like God miraculously pulled us out of something that the devil had intended to destroy us. And we can all recount times that the devil, we know he was after us, and most likely we were, if we had got what we saw coming, it would have been justice, because we were not innocent. And if we really look and think about the things that God has brought us through, many of those we brought up on ourselves. The pain that you have felt and experienced in your life, 80% of that was well deserved. According to the principle of justice by scripture, if we were living in the Old Testament, you would get what you deserve, because the Bible says an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. The thing God's son, when he sent his son to die for our sin, it introduced an entirely different dispensation or age, and that age is grace. And grace is simply saying that you're not going to get what you deserve. Grace is above mercy, which is saying, I'm not going to give you what you deserve, but grace is saying, I'm going to give you something that you don't deserve. In other words, I'm not going to send you to prison, but I'm even going to abolish your sentence as though it never happened. You don't deserve it, but I'm going to do it just because I'm God. And I thank God because the God of grace that I know don't look at all the messed up stuff that we've done in our life, but he looks at who we are. And I wish people could see us as God sees us. I wish we could see ourselves the way God sees us. But God sees us through the eyes of grace. He sees past your mistakes, past your bad attitude. Man, he knows you've been selling your food stamps, but you ain't going to hell for it. He knows you've been cheating and lying. He knows you bought that lottery ticket. Amen. Come on. As you try to hit that 1.5 billion, come on. You know that jackpot got a little bit too high, and you said, okay, I gotta get a piece of this, I gotta get a piece of this. And so you got that ticket by saying, if I hit it, I can bless the church. And you got an excuse for yourself. But thank God that he's gracious, and he had mercy upon you, even though you should have got paid back. God looks past. He's so merciful. He's so gracious. That whenever I think about who I am and who I could be because of our nature, it's amazing that we're still living and breathing, that we can still get up every day in our righteous mind, that we can come to a holy church of God, raise our righteous hands and say, God, I love you, and it don't have anything to do with what you did last night. God says, if you ask me to forgive you, I've forgiven you, and it's over and it's done. Come into the house of God, lift your hands, and come bold to the throne of grace, because you're just as righteous as the most righteous saint. Hello? Thank God, because he's a gracious God. Now look in the book of Romans. It says, Paul said it like this in Romans chapter 5 and verse 20. He says, moreover, the law entered that the offense may abound. Where sin abounded, he said, grace did much more abound. And you think about that, is that when you are at the most destitute place in your life, when you know you were living in sin, when you know you were walking in ungodly and you were not pleasing God, the times in your life that you should have paid for the most are the times that grace abounded even more.
Yes.
The times that you should have got, amen, what you had coming to you.
Yes.
But God stepped in, and for some unknown, unexplained reason, you got out of that thing. Yes. And God fixed that thing. Yes. And God had mercy upon you.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
In the midst of your sin. I think it's an indication of what the scripture meant when it says that while we were yet sinners, God didn't wait till you got prettied up, cleaned up, till you got baptized. He didn't wait till you spoke in a few tongues, you attended a few new members' classes. God took your nasty self when you were at the bottom of the barrel and nobody had any time for you. God says, that's my child. I love him. I'm not going to leave him.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yes.
That as sin reigned unto death, even so might grace reign unto righteousness, unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord.
Yes. Yes.
The principle of grace is the most key component and the most critical component of Scripture. Because grace keeps you from trying to work your way to heaven. Grace keeps you from trying to, amen, smooth your way to heaven. From trying to get enough friends in the church. Trying to get enough folk, prayer partners that can pray you into heaven. Grace keeps you from trying to have to depend upon people to get you to heaven. People can get you to heaven, but only grace can get you to heaven. Sometimes you gotta understand when you really walk in grace, it don't depend on nobody being around you. God will take your messed up self and cleanse you up by the work of the grace of God. So the act of grace is by faith. In other words, I simply got to believe that God loves me that much.
Yes.
It's not how much
Money I put in the offering plate, although we do want you, thank you, Elder Colson.
Amen.
You do owe the time some last week. God is gracious. We ain't that gracious. We need you to pay it. But it's not how much money. If you do get the lottery, you better bring in time. The grace says, I don't deserve nothing I get. Ooh, we are just walking miracles. We are just walking testimonies of the grace of God. Our life could be a book. You couldn't even write a book like this. They were classified as fiction. Because no way could you have gone through that and still need to tell about it. You should be in a mental institution right now. Amen. You should not have your right mind. All your family, your kids should be taken away from you. But grace. When people judged you and looked at you and said, you crazy, like your mama was crazy, like your daddy was crazy, and they look back down your bloodline and say, you just like your family. Grace says, you get it. Grace says, no way. I'm going to flip the script. You're going to be the first one in your family. You're going to be the first one in your family to be saved and in righteousness, to be a minister. You're going to write a book. You're going to start a business. You're going to get this thing together. Your family name will not be a stain. You're going to make everybody in your family proud of you. And if the haters hate, let them hate. You're still going to be untouchable. Paul said it like this. He says, by the grace of God, yes, yes. I am what I am. Yes, yes. You might not like who I am. He says, by the grace of God, this is it.
Right.
Hello? Amen. So stop trying to make folk like you that will never like you. Amen. Some folk will never get comfortable with you. They will never accept who you are. As a matter of fact, they're mad because you're trying to get it together and get in church. Now everybody acting crazy because you're trying to do the right thing. Stop trying to make folk like you. If the world hates you. If they hated me, why do you think they would like you? If they hated me, they sure enough gonna hate you. Because you are my children.
Amen.
So, thought about it. Sometimes what we do, you look at the Pharisee and the publican. Jesus gave this example, and he actually specified the reason that he had to give this example. This parable. He says, I'm telling you this for those that trust in themselves. Get that. Trust in themselves. It's a critical mistake to trust in yourself. Have you ever trusted in yourself? How'd that work for you? Funny how you trust in yourself. We get judgmental at all the folk that let you down, but you've let yourself down more than anybody else. You've disappointed yourself, and you really can't point the finger at nobody because you have messed up more times. Amen. With all your New Year's resolutions, you have messed up more times than you can count.
Amen.
So Jesus had an answer for those that trusted in themselves. I'm going to get it together. This is my year of exodus. I ain't gonna go around that same merry-go-round. Yet still you see yourself already almost turning. And you're just a month into the year. For those that trust in themselves, if they were righteous. And those that went a step farther, that despised other people that weren't as far along in this walk as they are. Funny how we can come to church 5 Sundays in a row. Pay tithe for 3 weeks in a row. Hello. Now everybody else, you gotta look at how far I've come. You wanna learn how to walk this thing, just look at me. I'll show you. And we think we're the best example of walking in righteousness. When in reality, we got a long way to go.